And hello, everyone, and welcome. Glad to be a part of your class here as we talk about covering the sports games. And joining me here, my name is Scott Warman, by the way, is a longtime friend. I've known Dan McLaughlin for many, many years. Danny has been the TV voice of the St. Louis Cardinals for nearly 25 years. We both worked together now at Fox Sports Midwest for the last few years, but Dan has done so many other things over the years. He's the voice of the St. Louis University Billikens on TV as well. He does Missouri Valley Conference basketball. And Dan, thanks so much for the time. Really appreciate you joining us here today.
I was a really hard guest for you to get, Scotty. And I'm assuming my check is in the mail. Good to see you, buddy. How are you?
Yes, it is. I'm doing great. I just gave a brief synopsis of your bio. And Danny actually started doing Cardinal games at a very young age, at the young 20s. But not only that, Danny, just tell some of the students what else you've done, because you've done stuff on a national basis as well.
Sure. Did a little bit of the NFL on Fox. Did a lot of the ESPN stuff. Used to do about 70 events for them throughout the year, whether it be college football, basketball, baseball. Did volleyball. I've done a lot of radio stuff in terms of talk shows and radio play-by-play of various events. So, you know, tried to make myself as well-versed as I could to do play-by-play. It's always what I wanted to do. It's what I wanted to do when I was a little kid. Played sports. Got me through college. That was great to have a scholarship to put me through school. But never wanted to be on the field professionally. Never was good enough to do it professionally. Wanted to be behind the mic and living my dream. So it's provided me a great living, and it's something I always wanted to do. So, you know, wherever you want to go with this interview, Scotty, I probably have done something with it.
Yes.
I've gone into the website podcasting side of things too, which has been an interesting part of where I think every young student needs to look at now in their lives, because everybody has one of these, which is That's a phone. Right. And all of us now are reporters in a sense, wherever we walk on the streets. So there's a lot of different things that you can do with a degree in communication. So there's a lot of avenues, a lot of fun, and a lot of stories along the way.
There's no doubt about it. We'll get into podcasting just for folks to not only know the Scoops with Danny Mac, by the way, is the podcast, but also he has a radio show. What's that? .com.
DannyMac.com. And I would encourage any student to log on and get my numbers up as high as they can, because that always benefits the sponsors. But thank you. I digress.
All right. Let's get right into it. I want to go a little bit further down the line with our conversation as far as this year. Obviously, it's changed all of our lives. But first and foremost, and I know you and I have even had this conversation before and talking to other students in the past, what are a couple of things that you think have been critical in your success, and what can be critical to other students' success getting into this business?
Well, just generally, I think in our world today is reading and taking in everything outside of sports. Now, I do think that people have tuned into games to get away from, I look at it this way. For instance, Scotty, not to get too personal here. So, you know, my mom has got cancer and she's 75 and has been at her home. And we're from St. Louis and I'm doing the St. Louis Cardinal games. So I know that she looks at those 3 hours when we're doing a baseball game. There's two things that she loves: her grandkids, which she hasn't been able to see because of COVID, and we haven't been able to be physically around her for obvious reasons, and a baseball game. So my thing has been trying to be ultra positive during the baseball game. So that's number one, is like just being upbeat and excited to be there, even though there's no fans in the stands and there's, you know, it's a dull atmosphere, to be quite honest with you. It's different, especially when we're doing the road games in the studios. The other thing is, and I've always tried to do this, whether it was pre-COVID or not, is having some sense of what's going on in our world outside of sports. I mean, most of my stuff that I take in, that I read in books and newspapers, I read a ton of newspapers around the country every single day, as you know, is non-sports related. Just that's kind of how I am. It's politics, it's news, and I'm not going to get into politics one way or another. It's just, I like to read news, and we need to be as well-versed as you can be on what's going on in our world. And now with what's happening in our world, you know, you better be ready for it, because things are going to be hit at all times. And we've dealt with that in our games, as you know. You know, we're in the middle of a game, and they may ask us, you know, there was a time, I guess, a few weeks ago where players were saying whether or not they wanted to play the game. And it was for their own reasons as to why they were making a stand. And if you don't know why they're doing that, then you're going to look a little foolish if you go on the air. So that's a good example as to why you better know other things outside of ball two and strike one.
And just to add to that, because when I do travel with Dan on the road, sometimes during reporting, we sit next to each other. Dan always has his iPad, and you're always watching movies or you're watching shows. So that's another thing beyond reading papers, that you make yourself more well-versed.
That's about the only time that I have to myself. I have four kids, so we're busy at home. But that's on a plane, if we're traveling, is the only time I get to take a little break usually, and just kind of – I download a lot of movies and a lot of shows, and I just kind of turn it all off for a couple hours. Or, as you know, I have a book. I always have a book with me. I read a book. I read books nonstop. I love reading books. So I'll do that. And it's not all about reading the stats and understanding the box scores, if our students know what a box score is anymore, if all they read about is Fangraphs and stats and Sabermetrics, which is great. That's part of the game. But that's changed in the game, too, of how we do baseball and even other sports. But it's just, you got to be broad, man. You got to have more than just what's happening on the field. There has to be an understanding that there's a world outside of the stadium, is what I'm trying to say.
Well, the profession of covering games has changed, obviously, since you started doing this. And get into that, because, obviously, analytics is a big part of really almost any sport. But, obviously, I think it's probably – forefront with the game of baseball. And I know this because I've obviously watched the games, work with you. You've really implemented that more and more as time has moved on in the Cardinals telecast.
For sure. We have a great history of, you know, our franchise has been around for over 100 years, and we've had a lot of success. And I work with four or five different partners that come from different parts of decades of baseball, to where they may not understand analytics or want to talk about analytics, and that's fine. And I get that. And so my goal is doing the play-by-play for this particular franchise in this particular market. And I do think there are markets that are different, but in St. Louis specifically, I'm trying to appeal to the older generation, the middle generation, and the younger generation. So I'm sprinkling in analytics. I'm sprinkling in a story on an older player. I'm talking about the history of the team. And I understand that's not everybody's cup of tea. I get it. But I am trying to bring in everyone. And by the way, I also know the number one thing clearly on all of it is to talk about the players on the field of now. That's why we tune in. People aren't tuned in to see me, and people aren't tuned in to see the umpire. They're tuned in to watch the game and the players of the field. So that's, the game is about the players. But we are also, which we have completely forgotten, and it's been utterly lost in everything we do in sports, we are there to entertain. We are supposed to entertain. And so as we go through the generations of people that follow these games, we have to entertain them and make it fun. I mean, the game is, especially as it goes with baseball, you know, a 2-hour and 20-minute game used to be, you know, when I was growing up, that was kind of a longer game. 2 hours and 20 minutes, we're like high-fiving. We're like, man, we just stole money because we get out of there in 2 hours and 20 minutes and 9 innings. You know, it's now every game is about 3 hours. I think the average time is about 3 hours of a 9-inning game in a normal season is about 3 hours and 5 minutes, 3 hours and 10 minutes. And so when we're on television, I do the TV. We now, if you think about your television screen, we're giving you balls, strikes, we're giving you where the runners are, we're giving you the position of where the players are with shifts, which is now a big part of the game. So I better be bringing out something other than what you're seeing. So I try to give a lot of stories of the players and the background and the history and how it ties into today and all those things. And you know, I do a ton of history and a lot of interviewing players. So this season has been challenging in the fact that I can't go down and talk to Mike Shildt. I can't go visit with a player. Now, I try to text with him. I try to call him, but it's very limited. You know, human to human talking is different than texting a guy. And sure. Yeah, it's just a different thing. So we will get back to that someday, but that part of it has been a challenge.
Well, that kind of leads me into the next question. Let's talk about the changes of your profession specifically. And you've kind of touched on a little bit, Mike Shildt being the manager of the Cardinals. I mean, when you're traveling or even at home, you specifically, but the other broadcasters, radio or TV, have full access with at least the Cardinals managers. And we know this through time, you know this specifically, that it changes from manager to manager, but still having that access and telling stories. That's not the case. Tell some of the students about how you have had to change as a broadcaster and what has changed, not only from that dynamic, but again, as you touched on, especially games that are away and you're not traveling with the team now, Dan.
So with away games, we have basically the monitor that you're seeing at home, the TV screen that you see at home, that's how I call the game. So it takes me back to when I was 5 years old and we'd get one game on TV, the game of the week, and I'm listening to Vin Scully and I would turn down the sound and I would call the game. That's what I'm doing. Now, I also have, they give us a feed to where it shows us, as you know, Scotty, it gives us a camera that's just it shows you the view of the field. So I've got my camera, trying to visualize it for you guys. So I got the feed here of the picture of the television screen you see at home. And then right behind that is a monitor that gives me, and it looks like a bunch of ants running around because I can't
see.
It's
a wide shot.
It's a huge wide shot. So at least I can see if somebody's shifting. I can see if somebody's running. And I can see the bullpens if somebody gets up and starts to throw. But other than that, I'm left to kind of guess, and that's how I call the game. So when I'm watching, and I've done, as you mentioned, almost 25 years of Cardinal baseball, I can tell with a swing. I can tell with mannerisms. I can tell with, for the most part, I've been caught a couple of times where I just start laughing. But I can tell if it's a ball that's well hit, you know, I'm at the mercy of the director to hopefully cut the game quickly to go to the shot of the outfielder or whatever, so I could see it. But there was one game I said, and DeJong has gotten into this one and it's in shallow left field and the catch is made, you know, one of those kind of things, you know, and I just started laughing at myself, you know, you got to have fun with it. I thought it was hilarious. I wasn't mad at all. I just had fun with it, you know.
Kind of like Bob Uecker, just a bit outside.
Exactly, you know, you just got to have fun with it. So that's the way I did it. But that's how we're doing the road games, because we're not traveling on the road. And then the home games, we're at the ballpark. So that's kind of a sense of normalcy.
But I would imagine difficult, and you and I've actually had personal conversation about it, is the fact that there's no crowd. They have pumped in crowd noise, except the other night they lost it for a while in Milwaukee. Yeah. But it still has to be, even when you're just in a studio with your cohort, your analyst, it's still got to be very difficult, I would imagine, because it's not your element that you're used to.
So I'm pumping in about 8 cups of coffee in me to make sure I'm bouncing up the walls. No, I have made it a point, like I said earlier, I think it's incumbent on all of us to be positive, like be excited to be at the ballpark, give people let them show that there's an enjoyment here, that because there's a lot of negative stuff out there, right? And if Absolutely. You're tuning into a baseball game, you're at least a baseball fan. Now let's keep you. Let's give you like a couple of guys that are excited to be there. And I understand that the atmosphere is stale. I get it. There's no fans, and I feed off the fans as an announcer. And we have great crowds in St. Louis normally. Where many times on a Tuesday night against a poor team, we got 40,000 people at the ballpark. So it's really easy to be excited when you're in the dog days of summer and there's 40,000 people there. You feed off of that. So I find it, you know, it's incumbent on me to make sure that I am excited. And I should be excited. You know, this is baseball. We're doing sports for a living. And I've never forgotten that. I really I would encourage all the students, never forget what you're doing. This is still sports. You know, you're not, this isn't really, this is what you want. This is what you enjoy. This is what you wanted to do when you first got into a classroom. And I have to remind myself of that too sometimes when I'm tired and beat up and traveling for God knows how long. It's still fun, man. It's a lot of fun. And even though there's not the crowd there, but still enjoy it. So I purposely am being maybe over the top probably of just trying to be excited about, you know, a ground ball or a fly ball or a great play. I just think it's fun and I try to make it fun. And that's, I really try to make a conscious effort to do that.
Let's remember, we didn't have sports for a while either.
Right.
All right. We just got a couple more minutes left, and I want to talk about podcasting, as you mentioned. That's a huge thing and can be a huge success, even for people that are just getting into the business. Now, ScoopsWithDannyMac.com, you've really built this thing up and had a lot of success. Just quickly tell some of the students, Danny, if you will, about podcasting and the success that you've actually had.
It's been really interesting, and it's taken me down so many different roads that I did not understand. Social media can be a pit of negativity, and I get that. I used social media as a way to promote. And so this is probably, Scott, I would say 8 or 9 years ago, I was told by our company, they said, hey, you have to get on social media. I did not want to be on social media. So I went on Twitter, and I would make these stupid statements that were so obvious and hashtag it with scoop, like, hey, I scooped you. And it was like, hey, the Cardinals are going to play tonight at 7:10. You just got scooped. So I just start, you know, scoops. And it just kind of was just a joke, right? Well, all of a sudden, all these people started following me. And I got up to, I'm up to close to 90,000 people on Twitter. So I said, you know, I ought to try to look at like doing something with this. I mean, I got 90,000 people. I could probably monetize it. And that's what I did. So long story short, met with a guy, turned it into a website. The website has turned into video and writing. And then I built a studio and built a podcast center. And it's gone into what will be a TV show. I mean, it's just, it led to one avenue after another. And I also love interviewing people. And it's, and the interviews that I do also inform me for the play-by-play. So sometimes I know, like, I'll do an interview with somebody that I know won't get a huge amount of traction, but yet I'll use the interview as a way to give me insight into what I'll use in the game for information for that night's game.
Absolutely.
It's just a way to interview people. It's fun. I enjoy it. I've loved doing it.
And you've gotten a great response from it, too.
It's been very good. And it can go, that's the other thing. If you build it up enough, you can go national with it, or advertisers want, you could, that's the other thing about it. There's a business side to it too, that people will enjoy once you get into it. And that's the kind of fun part. And I know we got to wrap it up, but there, the avenues for that to go along, you learn as you go. And that's the amount of information I've learned in doing that. And I think that's where this thing is going for young students. You have this at your fingertips. We didn't have that when we first started. It was just get behind a microphone and hopefully you get hired by a radio station. You have this in now in your basement. It's there for you to do if you want it. And that's what people need to remember, is that it's, you got to want to work. You got to want to promote. You got to want to try to get those good guests. But if you want to do the work, you can make this thing happen.
All right. One last thing before we let you go. You mentioned Vin Scully. We used to watch him at our age when we were kids growing up. You can do this if you want to or not, but Dan is not only a great broadcaster, but he's an incredible impersonator. Can you give the students a little Vin Scully before, as we wrap things up?
Let's see. It would have to be something.
Not John Miller.
You don't Vin want Scully. John Miller? Okay.
You did John Miller.
Oh, Scott. I see you're putting me on the spot with this, but it would be, it's time for Dodger baseball. And here we have Scott Warman. And great to have him here and talking to you. Scott, it was wonderful. I can't thank you enough. And the Dodgers lost another one to the Cardinals. I'll tell you about Stan Musial right after this.
throw in a John Miller real fast because you were doing it the other day.
Scott Warman here. He's interviewing you, and he's really done a delightful job here. And telling the students all about how to get better with podcasting and radio and television. And it's been an enjoyable experience. See, you put me on the spot. I got to build these up. I got to build these up.
Stuff. I could do this for an entire broadcast if you could just do impersonations for 3 hours.
Just don't impersonate me. But impersonations are the greatest form of flattery. They're the nicest guy.
Absolutely.
I've met so many people in this business, and that's the other thing I would tell the students. You're not bothering people by going up and shaking a hand or, I guess, giving an elbow now and mm-hmm. saying hello.
Absolutely.
It goes a long way. It really does.
Danny, thank you for the time. Really appreciate it, buddy.
You got it, buddy. We'll see you very soon, I'm sure.
Absolutely. That's Dan McLaughlin, longtime TV voice of the St. Louis Cardinals. We really appreciate him joining us here today.